is the second chapter of the book Rajyoga, and the name of the chapter is The First Step Towards Rajyoga. Rajyoga is divided into 8 steps. The first is Yama, that is non-killing, truthfulness, non-stealing, non-continence and non-receiving of any gift. Next is Niyama, cleanliness, contentment, mortification, study and self-surrender to God. Then come the asana or posture. Pranayama, that is controlling the vital force of the body. Pratyahara, or making the mind introspective. Dharana, or concentration. Dhyana, that is meditation. And Samadhi, that is super consciousness. The Yama and Niyama, as we see, are moral training. Without these as the basis, no practice of yogi will succeed. As this practice becomes established, the yogi will begin to realize the fruit of his practice. Without these, it will never bear fruit. A yogi must not think of injuring anyone through thought, word or deed, and this applies not only to man but to all animals. Mercy shall not be for man alone, but shall go beyond and embrace the whole world. The next step is asana, that is posture. A series of exercise, physical and mental, is to be going through every day until certain higher state are reached. Therefore, it is quite necessary that we should find a posture in which we can remain long. It is very necessary to find a posture in which we can remain long. That posture which is easiest for each one is the posture to use. For one man, it may be very easy to think in a certain posture, but this may be very difficult for another. We will find later on that in the study of these psychological matters, there will be a good deal of action going on in the body. Nerve currents will have to be displaced and given a new channel. New sorts of vibration will begin. The whole constitution will be remodeled, as it were. But the main part of the action will lie along the spinal column. So that the one thing necessary for the posture is to hold the spinal column free, sitting erect, holding the three parts, the chest, neck and head in a straight line. Let the whole weight of the body are supported by the ribs, and then you have an easy natural posture with the spine straight. You will naturally see that you cannot think very high thought with the chest in. When your chest is in, you can't think very high thinking. This portion of the yoga is a little similar to the Hatha Yoga, which deals entirely with the physical body. The aim of the latter is to make the physical body very strong. That is, in Hatha Yoga, the focus is on the physical body to make it very strong. We have nothing to do with that here because its practices are very difficult and cannot be learned in a day, and after all, do not lead to any spiritual growth. Many of these practices you will find in a Dilsarte and other teachers, such as placing the body in a different posture. But the object in this is a physical, not psychological. There is not one muscle in the body over which a man cannot establish a perfect control. The heart can be made to stop or go on at his biding, and in the same way, each part of the organism can be made to work at his bidding. The result of this part of yoga is to make man live long. Health is a chief idea, the one goal of the Hatha Yoga. He is determined not to fall sick, and he never does. He lives long. 100 years is nothing to him. He is quite young and fresh when he is 150, without one hair turned grey. But that is all. A banyan tree lives sometimes 5,000 years. But it is a banyan tree and nothing more. So if a man lives long, he is only a healthy animal. One or two ordinary lessons of a hatha yoga are very useful. For instance, some of you will find it a good thing for headache to drink cold water through the nose as soon as you get up. The whole day your brain will be nice and cool and you will never catch cold. It is very easy to do. Put your nose into the water and make a pump action in the throat. After one has learned to have a firm, erect seat, he has to perform, according to certain school, a practice called the purifying of the nerves. This part has been rejected by some as not belonging to Rajyoga, but as so great an authority as the commentator, Shankaracharya advises it. I think it fit that it should be mentioned, and I will quote his own direction from his commentary to Shvetashvara Upanishad. The mind whose dross has been cleared away by pranayama become fixed in brahmana. Therefore pranayama is pointed out. First the nerves are to be purified, then comes the power to practice pranayama. Stopping the right nostril with the thumb, with the left nostril fill in air according to one's capacity, then without any internal throw the air out through the right nostril, closing the left one. Again inhaling through the right nostril, eject through the left according to capacity. Practicing this 3 or 5 times at 4 intervals of the day, before dawn, during midday in the evening, and at midnight in 15 days or a month, purity of the nerves is attained. Then begins pranayama. Practice is absolutely necessary. You may sit down and listen to me by the hour every day. But if you do not practice, you will not get one step further. It all depends on the practice. We never understand these things until we experience them. We still have to see and feel them for ourselves. Simply listening to explanation and theory will not do. There are several obstructions to practice. The first obstruction is an unhealthy body. If the body is not in a fit state, the practice will be obstructed. Therefore, we have to keep the body in a good health. We have to take care of what we eat and drink and what we do. Always use a mental effort, what is usually called Christian Science, to keep the body strong. That is all. Nothing further of the body. We must not forget that health is only a means to an end. If health were the end, we would be like animals. Animals rarely become unhealthy. The second obstruction is doubt. We always feel doubtful about things we do not see. Man cannot live upon words, however he may try. So doubt comes to us as to whether there is any truth in these things or not. Even the best of us will doubt sometimes. With practice, within a few days, a little glimpse will come. Enough to give you encouragement and hope. As one commentator on yoga philosophy say, when one proof is realized, however little it may be, that will give us faith in the whole teaching of a yoga. For instance, after the first few months of training and teaching, you will begin to find you can read another's thought. They will come to you in a picture form. Perhaps you will hear something happening at a long distance. When you concentrate your mind and try to do so, these glimpses will come. Just a little bit at a first, but enough to give you faith and strength and hope. For instance, if you concentrate your thoughts on the tips of your nose, in a few days you will begin to smell most beautiful fragrance, and that will be enough to show you that there are certain mental perceptions that can be made obvious without the contact of physical object. But we must always remember that these are only the means. The aim and end and goal of all this training is liberation of soul, absolute control over nature, and nothing short of it must be the goal. We must be the master and not nature. Neither body nor mind must be our master. And neither must we forget that the body is mine and not I. The bodies, a god and demon, went to learn about the self from a great sage. They studied with him for a long time, and at last the sage told them, though the self art the being, thou art seeking. Both of them thought that their bodies were the self. We have got everything, they said. And both of them returned to their people and said, we have learned everything that is to be learned. Eat, drink, and be merry. We are the self. There is nothing beyond us. The nature of the demon was ignorant, clouded, so he never inquired any further, but was perfectly satisfied with the idea that he was God. That by the self was mean the body, but the God had a purer nature. He at first committed the mistake of thinking, I, this body, am Brahmana. So keep it strong and in health and well dressed and give it all sorts of bodily enjoyment. But in a few days, he found out that this could not be the meaning of the sage. There must be something higher. So he came back and said, sir, did you teach me that this body is the self? If so, I see all the body dies. The self cannot die. The sage said, find it out. Thou art that. Then the god thought that the vital force which worked the body were what the sage meant. But after a minute, he found that if he ate, these vital forces remained strong. But if he starved, they become weak. The god then went back to the sage and said, sir, do you mean that the vital forces are the self? The sage said, find out for yourself, thou art that. The god returned once more and thought that it was the mind. Perhaps that is the self. But in a few days, he reflected that thoughts are so various. Now good, now bad, the mind is too changeable to be self. He went back to the sage and said, sir, I do not think that the mind is the self. Do you mean that? No, replied the sage. Thou art that. Find out yourself. The god went back and at last found that he was the self beyond all the thoughts, one without birth or death, whom the sword cannot pierce, or the fire burn, whom the air cannot dry, or the water melt, the beginningless and birthless, the immovable, the intangible, the omniscient and the omnipotent being, and that it was neither the body nor the mind, but beyond them all. So he was satisfied, but the poor demon did not get the truth, owing to his fondness for the body. This world has a good many of this demonic nature, but there are so gods too. If one proposes to teach any science to increase the power of sense enjoyment, he finds multitudes ready for it. If one undertake to show mankind the supreme goal, they care nothing for that. Very few have the power to grasp the highest, fewer still the patience to attend to it. But a very few also know that if the body be kept for 1,000 years, the result will be the same in the end. When the force that hold it together go away, the body must fall. No man was ever born who could stop his body one moment from changing. Body is the name of a series of changes. As in a river, the masses of the water are changing before you every movement, and new masses are coming, yet taking similar form. So is it with this body? Yet the body must be kept strong and healthy. It is the best instrument we have. This human is the greatest body in the universe, and a human being the greatest being. Man is higher than all animals, than all angels. None is greater than man. Even the devas will have to come down again and attain to salvation through a human body. Man alone attained to perfection, not even the devas. According to the Jews, Mohammedans, God created man. After creating the angels and everything else, and after creating man, he asked the angels to come and salute him. And all did except Iblis. So God cursed him and he became Satan. Behind this allegory is the great truth that this human birth is the greatest birth we can have. The lower creation, the animal, is dull and manufactured mostly out of tamas. Animal cannot have any high thoughts, nor can the angels or devas attain to direct freedom without him birth. In a human society, in the same way, too much wealth or too much poverty is a great impediment to higher development of the soul. It is from the middle classes that the great one of the world come. Here the forces are very equally adjusted and balanced. Returning to our subject, we come next to pranayama, controlling the breathing. What has that to do with concentrating the power of a mind? Breathe is like the flywheel of this machine. In a big engine, you find that flywheel first moving, and that motion is conveyed to the finer and finer machinery until the most delicate and finest mechanism in the machine is in the motion in accordance. This breath is that flywheel, supplying and regulating the motive power to everything in this body. There was once a minister to a great king. He fell into disgrace, and the king, as a punishment, ordered him to be shut up in the top of very high tower. This was done, and the minister was left there to perish. He had a faithful wife, however, and at a night she came to the tower and called to her husband at the top to know what she could do to help him. He told her to return to the tower the following night and bring with her a long rope, a stout twine, a pack thread, a silken thread, a beetle, a little honey. Wondering much, the good wife obeyed her husband and brought him the desired articles. The husband directed her to attach the silken thread firmly to the beetle, then to smear his horns with a drop of honey, and to set him free on the wall of the tower with his head pointing upward. She obeyed all these instructions, and the beetle started on his long journey. Smelling the honey before him, he slowly crept onwards and onwards and onwards in the hope of reaching it, until at last he reached the top of the tower. When the minister grasped the beetle and got possession of the silken thread, he told his wife to tie the other end of the pack thread, and after he has drawn up the pack thread, he repeated the process with stout twine, and lastly with the rope. Then the rest was easy. The minister descended from the tower by means of the rope and made his escape. In this body of ours, the breath motion is silken thread, and laying hold of that and learning to control it, we grasp the pack thread of the nerve current, and from these the stout twine of our thoughts, and lastly the rope of prana, controlling which we reach freedom. We do not know anything about our own bodies. We cannot know. At best, we can take a dead body and cut it into the pieces, and there are some who can take a live animal and cut it into the pieces in order to see what is inside the body. Still, that has nothing to do with our own bodies. We know very little about them. Why do we not know? Because our attention is not discriminating enough to catch the very fine movements that are going on within. We can know of them only as the mind, as it were, enters the body and become more subtle. To get that subtle perception, we have to begin with the grosser perception. So we have to get hold of that which is setting the whole engine in motion, and that is prana, the most obvious manifestation of which is the breath. Then, along with the breath, we will slowly enter the body, and that will enable us to find out about the subtle forces, how the nerve currents are moving all over the body. And as soon as we perceive that and learn to feel them, we shall begin to get control over them and over the body. The mind is also set in motion by these different nerve currents, so at last we shall reach the state when we have a perfect control over the body and mind, making both our servants. Knowledge is a power, and we have to get this power. So we must begin at the beginning, at the pranayama, restraining the prana. This pranayama is a long subject and will take several lessons to illustrate it thoroughly. We will take it part by part. We shall gradually see what are the reasons for each exercise and what forces in the body are set in motion. All these things will come to us, but it requires constant practice, and the proof will come by practice. No amount of reasoning which I can give you will be proof to you until you have demonstrated it for yourself. As soon as you begin to feel these currents in motion all over you, doubt will vanish, but it requires hard practice every day. You must practice at least twice every day, and the best times are towards morning and the evening. When night passes into a day and day into night, it has to pass through a state of relative calmness. The early morning and the early evening are the two points of calmness. Your body will have a like tendency to become calm at those times. We will take advantage of that natural condition and begin then to practice. Make it a rule not to eat until you have practiced. If you do this, the sheer force of your hunger will break your laziness. In India, they teach children never to eat until they have practiced and worshipped, and it becomes natural to them after a time. A boy will not feel hungry until he has bathed and practiced. Those of you who can afford it will do a better to have a room for this practice alone. Do not sleep in that room. It must be kept holy. You must not enter the room until you have bathed and are perfectly clean in body and mind. Place flower in that room always. They are the best surroundings for a yogi. Also picture that are pleasing. Burn incense morning and evening. Have no quarreling or anger or unholy thought in that room. Only allow those persons to enter who are of the same thoughts as you. Then by and by there will be an atmosphere of holiness in that room. And when you are a miserable, sorrowful, doubtful, or your mind is disturbed, the very fact of entering that room will make you calmer. This was the idea of the temple and the church, and in some temples and church you will find it even now, but in the majority of them the very idea has been lost. The idea is that by keeping holy vibrations there, the place become and remain illumined. Those who cannot afford to have a room set apart can practice anywhere they like. Sit in a straight posture. The first thing to do is to stand a current of holy thoughts to all creation. Mentally repeat, let all being be happy. Let all being be peaceful. Let all being be blissful. So do to the east, south, north and west. The more you do that, the better you will feel yourself. You will find at last that easiest way to make yourself healthy is to see that others are healthy. And the easiest way to make yourself happy is to see that others are happy. And after doing that, those who believe in God should pray, not for money, not for health, nor for heaven, pray for knowledge and light. Every other prayer is selfish. Then the next thing to do is to think of your own body and see that it is strong and healthy. It is the best instrument you have. Think of it as being strong as adamant, and that with the help of this body you will cross the ocean of life. Freedom is never to be reached by the weak. Throw away all the weakness. Tell your body that it is strong. Tell your mind that it is strong, and have unbounded faith and hope in yourself. So we will do the next chapter, prana. We will understand what is prana. We will explain prana in the next chapter. If you like the video, subscribe the channel. Thank you.